Hi, BioPeople. We're going to follow up on our discussion of mitosis and meiosis by talking about chromosomal abnormalities. These are all terms that you should be familiar with by the end of this screencast, and we're going to start off by talking about karyotypes, and then move on to non-disjunction, Down syndrome, and something called amniocentesis. Remember that DNA is coiled up very tightly into something called a chromosome. A segment of the DNA that codes for a specific group of proteins is called a gene. You have a lot of genes that all determine different traits that you have. So for instance, you have a certain number of genes that code for how tall you are, what color hair you have, or what color eyes you might have. Somatic or body cells are diploid. Diploid means that they have 23 pairs of chromosomes. This is different from sex cells, like sperm and eggs, because sex cells are haploid. They have 23 single chromosomes rather than having 23 pairs. This means that body cells have a total of 46 chromosomes, whereas sex cells have a total of 23. This is what is called a karyotype. It shows all of the different chromosomes that were inside one person's cell and matches them up with their pair. Because we have 23 pairs of chromosomes here, we can determine that this actually came from a body cell rather than from a sex cell. Each pair is made up of two sister chromatids. 23 pairs in all. Now notice that this last pair, the 23rd pair, has two that look pretty different from one another, which is different than any of the other preceding pairs. This is because the last set of chromosomes, the XX chromosome or the X and the Y chromosome, determine the person's gender. If the person has an X chromosome and a Y chromosome, they are biologically male. If they have two X chromosomes, they are biologically female. Notice how the Y chromosome is very short and stubby compared to the X chromosome. If we look at this other person's karyotype, we can see that their X and Y chromosomes look a little bit different. Here we can see that they have two X chromosomes and no Y chromosomes, and so this tells us that this person is female. It's very important that all of your body cells should have 23 pairs of chromosomes. If there's a different number, too many or too few, then you have what's called a chromosomal abnormality. For instance, if you have an extra copy of chromosome number 21 and have three copies instead of two, we call it trisomy 21. This is what causes Down syndrome. Before giving birth, parents can choose to have their baby undergo something called an amniocentesis. This is where they take a small sample of the cells and fluid surrounding the baby and test it to see if it will have chromosomal abnormalities. Things like trisomy 21 will usually show up on an amniocentesis before the baby is born. However, this also raises a number of ethical questions. Should people then be allowed to terminate the pregnancy if they decide that they are not able to care for a Down syndrome child or a child with a serious chromosomal abnormality? This is an ethical question rather than a scientific question, but it's important to keep ethics in mind as we continue to discuss this topic. Remember that in mitosis, a diploid parent cell splits into two identical diploid daughter cells. In meiosis, we go through two rounds of division, transforming a diploid parent cell into four different daughter cells, each of which are haploid. Each of these has genetic variation thanks to two procedures called crossing over and homologous recombination. Every single daughter cell is different from the other daughter cells, as well as being different from the parent. Meiosis consists of two rounds of cell division, each one consisting of PMAT, prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase, just like in mitosis. However, since there are two rounds of it, we go from having a parent cell to having four haploid daughter cells. So we go from having a parent cell that looks like this, with two red chromosomes and two blue chromosomes, to having four daughter cells, each of which have one red and one blue chromatid. This is what happens in normal cell division. However, we're now going to take a look at what happens when it goes abnormally. In a nutshell, abnormal chromosome division occurs when you wind up with the wrong number of chromosomes in one of the resulting daughter cells. Instead of having one of each color, you wind up with too few or too many. Before we dive into the abnormal procedure, please remember this is a simplified diagram. You have 23 pairs of chromosomes, but here I've only done red and blue to keep things simple. Normally, half of the chromosomes wind up on one side and half of them wind up on the other side. However, sometimes this doesn't happen, and we wind up with too many chromosomes on one side and too few on the other side. So what if the cell split like this instead? This means that after meiosis I and one round of cell division, we would have one blue chromosome on the left-hand side and three chromosomes on the right-hand side. Usually the problems with cell division occur during anaphase, when the chromosomes are not pulled to the correct side of the cell. If we were to proceed through meiosis II, even if everything went perfectly from that moment forwards, we would wind up with all four daughter cells having an abnormal number of chromosomes. Instead of each one having one of each kind, you have some that have too few and some that have too many. So this is what happens if the problem occurs during meiosis I. Now let's see what would happen if the problem occurred during meiosis II rather than meiosis I. We're going to assume that the first round of division, meiosis I, prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase I, went perfectly, and we wound up with exactly the right number of chromosomes in the first round of cells. If cell division proceeds correctly from here, we'll wind up with four haploid daughter cells, each with the same number of chromosomes. But if one of them divides incorrectly, we're going to wind up with an incorrect number of chromosomes on one of the daughter cells, or possibly even two. So let's just say that this cell right here on the left is where the problem occurs. Usually the problem occurs during anaphase, where one chromosome fails to separate into two sister chromatids, and so too many of them are on one side, and too few are on the other side. This is what the daughter cells would look like after both rounds of meiosis if there was non-disjunction. Non-disjunction simply means that the sister chromatids failed to separate correctly. Even if this cell over here on the right divides perfectly, you still have half of your cells that are not correctly formulated in terms of the number of chromosomes that they have. Non-disjunction is much more common in older individuals. So the older someone is, the more sticky their chromatids become and the less likely they are to separate. This is why older parents are more likely to have children with chromosomal abnormalities. Non-disjunction can occur either in meiosis I, meiosis II, or in both. However, we can see here that having it occur in meiosis II is slightly better than having it occur in meiosis I. When we look at meiosis I non-disjunction, every single daughter cell down here has an incorrect number of chromosomes. However, if the first round goes correctly, only half of them have the wrong number of chromosomes, and so the resulting child would have at least a 50% chance of having no chromosomal problems whatsoever, but a 50% chance of having something like Down syndrome. I think that's all for now. I'll see you all in class. Make sure you bring questions.